Well, hello everyone. Thank you for joining us for this session. So over the next hour, we're going to be exploring how you go about accelerating STEM education using augmented reality, a lofty goal. So my name is Casper Tikier, and I'm the CEO and co-founder here at Zappa. And I'm delighted to be joined from Texas by the wonderful Matt McKee, who's the founder of Stone Oak Media. And as luck would have it, has the silkiest and smoothest voice made for radio, which you'll get to enjoy shortly. But before I introduce Matt properly, I thought I'd spend a minute or two on why we've always been so excited about the potential of AR in education. And that really was highlighted in some research we undertook with the media agency called Mindshare and a UK-based neuroscience company called NeuroInsight. And this was a while back. Now, NeuroInsight have done lots and lots of research for marketing companies and brands, really exploring the effectiveness of communication in different media and how our brains respond to this stimulus. But in our study, which was really the first of its kind then, we asked Heather Andrew, who was the CEO there, and her team to look at how a nationally representative sample of people completed a series of tasks using AR versus a tablet. And those tasks ranged from there was translation, trying on glasses, playing a game, viewing product packaging, wayfinding, etc. And what was really fascinating about that research is that across the board, irrespective of age or gender, we consistently saw that AR tasks fired up the brain in such a way to elicit almost double the levels of visual attention and indeed 75% increase in memory encoding. And so what we empirically proved was that AR really is a great tool for what we describe as active learning through doing, which corroborated, I guess, the other quantitative data we'd seen over the last decade, really. Now, when you apply active learning through doing and increased memory recall towards a learning and indeed an education environment, well, that becomes a really powerful stuff. But I guess that's enough about all that. And without further ado, let me introduce Matt properly. So Matt is the co-founder of the US education technology company called Stone Oak Media. Stone Oak was founded back in 2014 and indeed develops really cutting edge educational products that leverage really the latest advantage, not only in augmented reality, but indeed 3D design and 3D printing now. And so Stone Oak's initial products, which were developed in collaboration with us at Zappa, were really some of the first to bring project-based augmented reality enhanced STEM educational content into the classroom. Now, Matthew's professional experience includes working in a wide array of industries, from semiconductor design and development to big data analytics within the financial services industry, and he holds a degree in electrical engineering and an MBA. Matt, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you, Casper. So, it's my pleasure to be here.
Yeah, well, to kick things off, perhaps you could tell us then a little about how Stone Oak Media came about, or so almost the origin story, if you like, and share some of the insights in the process you've gone through in the last few years.
No, will do. Again, thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. It's my pleasure, and I love all the work that Zappa does. Love the platform. We're big advocates, so it's again a true pleasure to be here. Bit of housekeeping. My audio appears to be kind of cutting out periodically. So, if in fact you can't hear what I'm saying, if it cuts out again, probably latency issues on my side. Just kind of wave me down, and I'll pause and kind of rewind a little bit and cover again what I was speaking about. But yeah, like you said. Stone Oak Media was founded in 2014, initially to launch what was to be our first book, a book called Moon Vacation, which if you go to our website today, you'll still see listed as a coming soon product. For me, the genesis of that book was my background. So as a kid growing up here in the States, I always had a fascination with science and engineering, and in particular space. And so growing up, I would read all kinds of articles on the US space program, international efforts in space and science overall, and ended up growing up getting that engineering degree that you talked about, working in the engineering field for a number of years. Time passed, got married and had a couple kids, and wanted to instill in them a love of science and the same fascination and really wonder that I always held about that field. And so you know, they were very young when I began the process, but began exposing them to facts, which I myself find fascinating. Most people find kind of dry, but they found it kind of dry. And so I changed my tactic and began, you know, developing stories around the science concepts, basically following the adventures of a family, the Rockwell family that you see on the screen there. The dad is an asteroid miner, and they go on all kinds of adventures. And science is innately woven into those stories. It's not, you know, kind of like a Star Wars, using the Force kind of fictitious type of sci-fi, but it's more science-grounded, scientific kind of based sci-fi. And so, you know, developed not only that book, but a whole series after that. And thought, you know, this is pretty good stuff. Talked to a number of published authors in that space, and they thought it was pretty good as well. And you know, our first step in looking into this was really building a financial plan around it and really doing a thorough investigation of all the costs associated with developing a book like this from the standpoint of, you know, production of the book itself, which of course involves print production, you know, content creation, illustrations in particular. This was intended to be a storybook, a picture book. And then, you know, actually in the years prior to 2014, the establishment of this company, and we came across, and I forget where, and I forget when, it was maybe around 2005 or 2007, a very early implementation of AR. And in fact, it was done by General Electric. It was a, if I recall correctly, like a PDF that you could download, and it had a QR-like symbol, or maybe just a reference image of some kind. And it was on a piece of paper that you could print out. And then you use the camera on your computer, you could hold it up to this camera, and it used the processor on your computer to analyze things. And it showed you this picture of this GE wind turbine spinning around, GE being General Electric. And isn't that cool? And I was like, wow, that's amazing stuff. I kind of filed that away in my head. And when it came time to develop this book, I wanted to make it as engaging as possible. And so I thought, you know, let's investigate that and look at the costs associated with that and see what we can put together. So beginning in 2014, moving on into 2015, as we're building kind of the business plan around these books, I began investigating the AR space as it existed at that time. And of course, it's evolved significantly since then. But came across the name Zappar, the company Zappar, and a number of other companies. We actively reached out to them and wanted to learn more about their platforms and pricing and how it all works. And, you know, we ourselves, you know, my background, again, is pretty varied, but we had some pretty good skills in 3D had, you know, technical people that could actually do the work. And anyway, so we reached out to Zappar, and I forget who we spoke with there, but ultimately Caspar became involved in the conversation eventually, and was very impressed. And in fact, I don't know if you recognize this, Caspar, the little book of Zaps. I don't know if you still hand these things. Do you still have these things? Do you hand them out?
Oh, we do, but not many. Yeah, that is going back in time.
it's an antique, but you know, it was cool. So they very generously sent one of these to me, and it's a very small book. This, again, you can see the size of my hand here. You've got, you know, just maybe about half a dozen different, you know, Zap code experiences or VR or AR experiences on here. And so I got it in the mail, and I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. And so I you know, downloaded the app and scanned it and was very impressed, you know, duly impressed. And then I sat it down on my desk, and I got busy with other things. I kind of forgot about it for a while as I was working on, you know, securing illustrators and doing all the rest of the grunt work for developing this book. And one day my son, who's the oldest of our two kids, and he was pretty young at that time, he came into my office. He said, Dad, what is this thing? I said, oh yeah, that's the little book of Zaps. You want to try it out? And he said, yeah, I'll try it out. And so he actually gave him my phone, and he broke it out. And again, you've got, again, 1, 2, 3, maybe 5 different Zap codes in here. The kid was busy for the better part of an hour on this thing. And at that point, I was totally sold, absolutely sold. And I knew that, you know, we thought we had some great content with these books and a great storyline and science embedded into it. But if we could drive that kind of engagement, additional engagement through the use of AR, we had to make it happen. And so that kicked off a whole lengthy dialogue. And again, going back to that business plan, we looked at the financials, and we knew, again, it would be very expensive to develop a book like this for all the different reasons. And so we thought, hey, what about a Kickstarter campaign? And so we talked to Caspar about it at that time, and we put it together and launched it. And it was unsuccessful, but you know, that's okay. It's a learning experience. But we, you know, had storyboards and some draft illustrations that were gorgeous. We teamed up with an illustrator out of Los Angeles named Fareed Sandoval, who's a great guy, very talented. Did some preliminary work on that. And again, it was unsuccessful. But you know, we at the end of that failure, we kind of picked ourselves up and looked around at what we were able to accomplish. And some really good work was done, and thought, okay, this is a storybook whose time is maybe not right now. But it's a storybook, it's a picture book that people, maybe even educators, might buy because they want it. It's a nice to have, not a need to have, right? And so we looked around at the education space because this touched on so many educational points and thought, what could we do that would really kind of drive content that people are required to have? And so that speaks to curriculum. You know, teachers here in the States, I assume it's the same in the UK and elsewhere, they're required by standards to actually teach certain content at certain grade levels at certain times. It's pretty regimented, whether it be national standards or more local standards at the state level. And so we began kind of stepping back and looking at it and talked to Caspar about maybe a new approach, a curriculum-based approach, and thus was born our first endeavor, Solar System Expedition. And so on the next slide here, Grace, if I could have you forward to the next slide, or somebody, maybe Caspar, but just to give you an idea of what the overall process looked like, it's a Herculean effort to produce these kinds of books. You've got to do a lot of research, again, on the financials up front. You've got to do research on what are the curriculum standard requirements that are relevant for the target audience geographically and age-wise that you want to target with this content. And then once you do all that work, you've got to begin putting storyboards together, not only for the book itself, you know, here's how it's going to be laid out page by page, but also for the, in this case, AR experiences. And so what you're looking at here, and we keep everything, by the way, we never throw away anything. What you're looking at here are some early mock-ups of what we thought a book like this might look like. So we've got, you know, this 3D rendition of a desk, and you've got some early renditions of what these pages in this book might look like. And so you can see kind of a sequence of how things load up. Okay, you scan the book with the iPad, the planet pops up, and then you can do other things. So a lot of work went into this. Again, graphic development work, 3D content development work, and a lot of thought and a lot of iteration. And I'll show you a couple of other slides here relative to our development process. And the point I want to bring across here is the fact that Rome was not built in a day. Oh, go ahead.
I lost your sound there for a minute, but you're back.
Okay, yes, sir. Yeah, so Rome was not built in a day. And projects like this, we managed this not in an agile fashion, but it was a traditional waterfall project. It had a set beginning and an end with certain requirements we wanted to get done. But even within that, we went through different iterations of, hey, here's what we're thinking, you know, Caspar and team, what do you think? And they kind of sent it back, and it's like a ping pong match back and forth. But with each iteration of bounce, it got better and better and better and better over time until you get this very refined, very polished end product. So part of that, of course, is the you know, development of characters. Again, some of this work was done in the context of our original book, Solar System Expedition. You can see some of the characters, again, a family of four modeled on my family. You will note that the father has hair. So it's a work of fiction. I figured might as well go for it. Caspar knows what I'm talking about there. It's a lot of development. And with all this artwork and all the 3D content that's developed, less than a tenth of it actually makes it through to the finished product. And so again, a lot of work. I'm going on to the next slide. We have just an example of, this was an illustration of a base that's actually, the experience has been incorporated into the Water Cycle Engineer book that we have. We actually reused the content originally developed for Moon Vacation. This is a crater at the south pole of the moon called Shackleton Crater, which is about a mile deep. And we covered it, at least in this case, with a big dome, kind of a donut-shaped dome. And you can see here the development process, which takes weeks and weeks and weeks to develop these very refined illustrations. We'll revisit this illustration a little bit later on, but just a ton of additional work, and there's expense associated with this as well. Mm-hmm. All right, next slide. Yeah, so you know, similarly along the same lines, you can see certain illustrations in here of early pages that we had mocked up for the book. We have 3D models, the lander that we have, a model of the lander that's associated with our solar system book, a couple models of the lander. Getting the illustration kind of detail right for our characters, just perfect. Other illustrations, just a ton of work. And again, less than a tenth of that makes it through to the finished content.
That's really interesting, Matt. And
beyond then the sort of the storyline and putting this all together, where did the science come from then to sort of inform that storyline? You know, how did you sort of fact check yourself, if you like?
Well, it's a great question. So again, I go back to my kind of nerd roots, and I just as a hobby, I kind of keep track of all that kind of stuff. But in terms of the trends, you know, I'm going to read articles over time. The trends in the space program and different research and, you know, popular articles written on the topic as well. And so when it came time to write these books, we actually began to do some more in-depth research, both with Moon Vacation and with other books like Solar System Expedition and Water Cycle Engineer. And so case in point, this was after the books were developed, but one of the things that people have been saying for, you know, 10 plus years is, especially after the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, which is a kind of a U.S. satellite that's been orbiting the moon for a long time, it was scanning for a number of things, one of which is water ice on the moon. And so it actually found quite a bit of it in certain craters that were permanently cast in shadow. Now, of course, the sun rotates, or the moon rotates around the Earth, and the Earth and moon rotates around the Earth, and the Earth and moon rotate around the sun. And most of the moon is in light at some point in time, except for those regions at the pole that might have deep craters that are kind of permanently, given the angle of the light, kind of cast in shadow. And Shackleton Crater, named after the famed Antarctic explorer Ernest Shackleton, it's one of those places, again, a mile deep, and they have found literally millions of tons of water ice just sitting there in that crater. It's come from, you know, asteroids and comets impacting on the moon over time, and when they hit, they get this big kind of plume that pops up and it settles back down on the surface. And when it does, all that ice that settles on the regular surface that gets exposed to the sun, it sublimates, right? It goes away. But that portion that settles in the craters, it accumulates over time. And that's what's happened to the Shackleton Crater. And so NASA came out with a white paper that is the kind of the culmination of a continuation of a lot of the research done to date, talking about, you know, where to go. And so, early April, they came up with this white paper talking about the fact that, yes, next year they're going to be landing additional science, but also beginning with commercial payloads to the moon. Where are they going? They're going to the South Pole of the moon. Now, Water Cycle Engineer, which talks about this Moon Vacation, the storybook, picture book, even before that, again, it's been out for 5 years now. We talk about that. So moving quickly. So everything's in line. We consult with, you know, different, you know, people on structural calculations for the load for the roof of this moon base. We talked to Wired Magazine's physics blog writer, Dr. Red Elaine. For Water Cycle Engineer, we had a custom illustration done at the very bottom there for that particular book. And we wanted to have a subterranean base where you can apply what you've learned about the water cycle. Interesting little tidbit. I promise I'll be fast on this. We wanted to carve out a big space underground. And so we had the question of how big can an underground space be? So we actually wrote the dean of the Department of Mining Engineering at the Colorado School of Mines, one of the preeminent mining universities here in the States, and began a dialogue which lasted a couple months. And we asked the question, how big is the biggest space that can be carved out on the moon? And talked back and forth. She found the concept fascinating. But ultimately she said, you know, I don't know, but talk to these guys over here. And by these guys, it was really the CEO of the company Rock Science. And so Rock Science, if you're building tunnels or you're building a subway station underground or doing mining operations, doing whatever, and you want to model the rock and soil dynamics, you use their software. It's the preeminent software for that kind of, you know, geotechnical engineering kind of work. And so she hooked us up with the CEO. They modeled it for us. They said, under lunar conditions, as long as it's at least a half a kilometer underground, it could be a couple kilometers in diameter. So imagine a tube, you know, on its side, sliced in half to where the bottom is flat. The arch itself could be a couple kilometers in diameter. And so that's what we modeled out. And my initial concept looked like that rather boring cylinder that you see there. Fareed said, you know, no, that's not going to work. We got to make it more dynamic. So he came up with this more nuanced view that you see down below. But again, lots and lots of research, which is cool. It's nice to talk about. But for those folks interested in doing something similar in the future, we found, and by the way, this is just the tip of the iceberg. We've talked to so many people out there. If you come across in your research different people that have, you know, touched on or done research or are leading minds in whatever topic you're interested in, just write them. More often than not, they'll write back. And in fact, we've never been turned down. And you get some amazing stories out of these guys. Absolutely amazing stories. So,
I love that. That's great.
And I mean, that literally was the science bit. That's what I like about that.
So let's change tack a bit and talk about the turning, I guess, the theory of all of this into practice. So certainly one of the things we know is that it's one thing coming up with a nice AR idea, but it's something else altogether executing that in the real world and in a real world context. And I guess there's no harsher setting or environment than the classroom. So how did this actually play out in a school context practically? And what have you learned from speaking to teachers and kids about using AR in that environment as part of the STEM curriculum?
Great question. And it is a very fierce and a formidable crucible that the classroom is. You know, the primer that we had for this was really our engaging, my attempt to engage my own children on presenting science facts, which, you know, it's good for some people, you know, but not for everybody. And definitely for certain kids, most kids, I'd say that, you know, the facts are pretty boring. But if you can weave a story in there, all the better. If you can, you know, have a cool digital experience, even better. If you could combine all that into one thing, you've got the Holy Grail. Very difficult to do. And you think about the development work that we did ahead of time before engaging you, Caspar. And then, of course, the work that we did while engaging you. It takes a long time. I mean, many, many months to develop this kind of content. But it's worth it because it pays dividends in the end. And so it's interesting when you look at the books that we produced, both Solar System Expedition and Water Cycle Engineering in the Classroom. How it goes is something like this, you know, that the teacher's got, you know, a classroom set of books enough for, you know, where each student can have one, or maybe yet have one for each two students. They team up in pairs of two. And they give it to the students and they say, okay, kids, here, you know, here's an iPad, here's a couple books. Use the iPad to scan these lightning bullet shaped symbols at the top of the page of, you know, certain pages of the book for, you know, for each book, kind of record the measurements, and at the very end, apply what you've learned. And by the way, going back to curriculum, I mean, there's all kinds of curriculum standards that deal with the you know, teaching of certain concepts, right? You got to teach about measurement. You got to teach about measurement of distance, measurement of temperature. You got to teach about the planet. So you kind of check the list, at least relative to what we did. We check the list. But there's also additional requirements that deal with, you know, critical thinking, right? And so can you, in the context of a book, the goal is to hit as many of those requirements as you can. And so we were able to actually do that. And so the teacher said, yeah, use the iPad to scan the book at the very end. You know, pick a planet, in the case of Solar System Expedition, doesn't matter which planet, but make sure that the base that you design, they kind of sketch it out, is capable of handling the conditions on the planet that you chose. So they know that if they want to colonize Jupiter, gosh, it's really cold there. Well, how do they know? Because they measured it, right? And they know also that, you know, there's no, you know, surface, at least in a practical sense, that you can nail a base down to. It's going to be floating. So they know that because they've measured that the surface, which for gaseous planets is that area at one atmospheric pressure. Maybe having a floating platform is good. So in the book, we actually give them some ideas of things that they might want to include, and it's up to them to include those or not. But it's, you know, it's fascinating, you know, watching this. And I kid you not, even the troublemakers in class are engaged. And you know, looking at cool, you know, 3D renditions of planets, that's nice for about 30 seconds. Maybe a minute, and you find that with other AR solutions to the solar system. There's lots of platforms out there. I'm not going to mention names, but some big players have come into the space, and Caspar and I have talked about this many times. It's kind of like they took the solar system, or, you know, volcanoes, or name your topic, and they put it in a nice little Ziploc baggie, and there it is. And when it's time to cover that topic, they say, here's the plastic baggie, open it up and bring it out. Here's a volcano. And it's engaging for about 60 seconds. And the kids lose interest. There's no real reason to actually learn that content. Here we're giving them a reason, not only to learn about it and record information, but to actually think about it, interpret that information towards a final solution to the overall challenge. And the kids love the AR experiences. They love the interactive measurement of the planets up front. They usually kind of take turns if they're working in pairs of two. You know, where you have one kid taking measurements, one kid scanning, on the next planet they kind of flip-flop and then back and forth. But at the very end, I'd say equal to or almost equal to what they experience with the AR is that blank page that we give them. We say, not design a base. And the creativity, it's it's amazing that what comes out of that, and the engagement is off the charts. You'll actually see if they're working in teams, you know, multiple kids working on the same drawing at the same time, and then the teachers have them presented at the very end. So,
it is fascinating that, and I think it's that combination of digital and physical that I think's so smart in what you created. Because I think the thing is always that AR shouldn't be, it's not trying to replace teaching, and it's not trying to sort of get away from sort of pen and paper. It's about how it complements and builds that story out, I guess.
That's right.
And it's exactly fascinating to hear that that's exactly how, you know, I guess, you know, you've done that by design and how you've constructed the books, but also seeing that played out in terms of the way that people use it. Well, but I also remember you talking about the fact that, you know, for a lot of teachers, we know that, you know, that it's so busy and they've got so many things to think about. And actually having a narrative that helps them, you know, within the strictures of the STEM curriculum, deliver those goals in a way that means that they don't have to do a lot of extra pre-work was quite a plus as well.
Absolutely right. And in fact, that's a key point. So what teachers typically do, especially if they're used to this lesson, they'll spend about 2 minutes introducing it, and then they can go away and get coffee. Teachers love hands-off activities. They're kind of self-engaging, especially when they're as fully engaging as this kind of content is.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess these are just the different versions of these.
Yeah, so if you could back up a couple slides, I'll be very brief here, yeah. Slide 13. Yeah. There you go. So some different illustrations that we had done of certain planetary surfaces. You know, I think we've got on the next slide after this, Caspar, kind of a demo page from one of the books. You know, when we originally sold these books, and I'll talk about the business model later on, they were in black and white so that teachers could easily reproduce them. We sold them as PDFs. And so that's why they're black and white. But, you know, it's again, designed to be easy to use and something that's largely hands-off for the teachers. Again, very engaging. Again, there's, I think you can see a screenshot of that last page on slide 14. There you go, of what that looks like. And again, that's a key piece of the overall lesson there.
Great.
I was going to mention this. So normally we're going to actually do the demonstration as part of this presentation. You know, given the whole remote learning situation with COVID-19 that's going on across the globe right now with so many schools closed down, rather than spending a lot of time on this, or we can spend a little time if you'd like, Caspar, you guys can go to our website and just download the full book. We're making it available as a kind of a PDF again. The digital content in that book will be expiring August 1st, meaning that, you know, once you download the PDF, you can keep it forever. But when you scan the respective codes on these pages after August 1st, instead of pulling up the relevant content, a little splash screen is going to pop up and say, well, you know, content has expired. Please, you know, visit our website to, you know, purchase the full book. But again, to support people and, you know, help out during this time of community sacrifice, we thought we'd, working with Caspar, you know, make this available free charge. So give it a shot. You can check out the entire books.
Excellent. And these are more examples, aren't there? The question sheet at the end as well.
Yep. And to that point, we've actually got quizzes on both books before and afterwards. So go ahead.
Yeah. You touched on it there. So we talked about the sort of the idea and the vision behind Stone Oak and the practical application in the classroom. But, you know, there is a point where you do have to get down to the brass tacks of making this commercially viable as a business. And you know, you talk about the crucible of the classroom. You know, there really aren't many more complex, brutal, challenging environments like education that are full of tech companies looking to get involved. So talk us through the business model and kind of the learnings that you're happy to share, because I know there have been both good and bad.
Well, Caspar talked about my background prior to coming to this, which is in, you know, engineering and then big data, financial services, all private sector stuff. When you're dealing with schools, it's innately public sector. For the most part, you've got some, you know, nonprofits that are in that space as well. Maybe some for-profits, very few of those. But it's mainly dealing with government contracting. And, you know, the theory is it's very difficult to get in with any individual school district, but once you're in, it's the gravy train. That's the idea, as long as it actually pans out. But again, getting in is difficult. And so when we first began launching our books, I think I mentioned that, you know, we began selling them. In fact, we had two different formats. One was a PDF version that, you know, teachers could, you know, download. I think the cost was about 10 bucks. They could download, print out as many copies as they'd like for their classroom. The copyright on page 2 of the book said, hey, you know, this is only for, you know, for one classroom. Please don't distribute it further. And then we also sold a print book because, you know, some teachers just like having a print copy that looked good as opposed to something that they produced themselves. And we sold, you know, a decent number of PDF versions of the book. I'd say that was more popular than the print version, although we sold quite a few print versions. Our production costs, given the initial volume that we were dealing with, was very, very small. So we didn't have a lot of, you know, economies of scale relative to our print orders, which was, you know, expensive. And the PDFs, that was great. You know, it's the software solution. You sell it. You don't have to maintain the inventory. It just kind of goes out. You know, hooked up our website, e-commerce enabled it to where you could actually, you know, have the teachers, you know, check out, and then bam, there's the link to download the PDF. But once they purchase that PDF, you know, who knows what happens to it, right? And so, kind of, we knew this going into it, which is why we made that content as a similar to our current situation with the COVID-19 version of this book. Where it expires August 1st, we actually had all this content expiring like August 1st or September 1st of every year, so they had to renew it every year. But we imagined, we had no way of tracking it, the explosion where, you know, person A would give it to person B, C, D, E, and F, and then it's kind of like a viral thing after that. And so you can see some numbers, and I think Caspar and you and your team have done some research here recently on the total impact of these books, quite a bit of activation. Do you want to talk about that a little bit? Or,
well, I mean, I think it kind of goes back to the findings that we saw from your insight and the other quantitative data we've seen around other campaigns, which is that active learning through doing and the average dwell time. I think is the fascinating thing here of 2:27, which is way above our normal sort of platform average, not surprisingly, because it's in an education environment. But to see that level of engagement and interaction for each one of these pages is fantastic to see. And I mean, obviously, it was designed that way, which was great. So, no, it's obviously nice to see not only the sales data, but the scan data and dwell time come through and match each other and see people, as you said earlier, following these worksheets all the way through to the end and then delivering the sort of the paper piece to, from it. So that is encouraging. But yeah, I know what you mean about it's challenging asking people to play nice.
Absolutely. And you think about the education space, and good for teachers. You know, these are people who work often very, very long hours under difficult circumstances, usually underfunded, almost always underfunded. And so God bless them, they're scrapping for resources, trying to get whatever they can to enrich the minds of their students. And our hats off to them. And honestly, we knew that this would happen. And at least for the first few years of our selling these products, these PDFs, which we only discontinued in early 2019, so last year, it was, to be honest, to a certain extent, kind of a viral marketing play. Again, we could cut it off at the end of the year, so we knew that it wouldn't be propagating forever. But we cut it off for a reason, and that was in dealing with some of the larger districts here in Texas, in our local area of San Antonio. They said, you know, you've got some great content. These books are fantastic, and they like some of the content that we have. But we don't like that annual renewal model, and you know, we'd like to just buy it once and be done. And we said, well, you know, that creates a problem. We can't give you the PDFs because you guys are just reproduce it like crazy. And so we began moving at that point to just a print-only version, which, you know, for a lot of our international customers, we actually had a great guy, longtime customer out of Vietnam, who's ordered for the past few years. Again, we cut him off at the end of the academic year, and he wants to buy it again. And we say, you know, you got to buy the print books because, you know, the government of Vietnam, they inspect the mail. It's very, very difficult to get anything physical over here. The PDFs are great. So we took a hit from that standpoint, but there's benefit to it as well. Of course, we're kind of, you know, we're adding benefit to the school districts in that they have the content forever. There's no need to yearly renew. Benefit for us in that we're actually able to get paid for everything. It moves beyond the viral kind of free marketing. And you got to make money at the end of the day. And kind of jumping from that format on the left-hand side to the sales channels, You got to have, when you begin this process of looking at making a business out of something like this, and before talking to Caspar, before developing the storyboards, we began with a business plan, a set of financials, pro forma, based on our best gathering of information, which you can gather cost information pretty accurately, pretty effectively. It's that upside of sales that drives ultimately profit at the very bottom of the cash flow statement that drives everything else, right? And so you got to make sure that you've got the sales coming in. At the same time, you know, with any kind of new business, there's something called the valley of death. It's a business term, meaning that when you start a new product or a new business, you're going to be spending money, and the money in your account kind of goes down and goes down and goes down. But eventually, you start making money to the point to where you begin adding to your bank account, you break even, and then you're off and running at that point. So you've got to be able to hold your breath that amount and for that duration over the course of starting up of your business and launching your products. And so you've got to have some pretty good financing to make that happen. Having said that, there's different ways that you can do that. So you can launch a business, you can produce a product, you can put it on a website. Nobody's going to come there. You can go the distribution route, and that's a tornado siren that you see on the right-hand side there. You can actually put things on Amazon relatively quickly. The Amazon business model is rather hard on vendors. I mean, so if you're selling something on Amazon, they're going to keep at least 55%, and you got to pay to ship the product to them, and they're going to hold on to your money for at least 30 days. And so that's in stark contrast to other distributors in the education space that usually they say, well, we want to buy 100 product or whatever it is, or 50 product. Here's the money for it. And give us the product. Then they do whatever they want with that. So it's kind of money up front, which is a different business model. Easy, relatively easy. Pretty much anybody can get into Amazon with their product. Making any kind of money on that is difficult. In fact, for the first couple of years of selling on Amazon, we lost money on every single product we sold, but we still did it just to get the word out there and have that distribution channel. But we ultimately had to shut that down. Now things have changed here recently. We've been able to reduce some of our costs from a production standpoint on the back end. With the print production of these books, and we're thinking about going on back on Amazon. But if we do, we're making just a fraction of the overall sale price because it goes out in so many different ways. Dealing with educational distributors, very difficult to actually get in with those guys. They are constantly bombarded with everybody and their uncle trying to sell the next greatest educational whatever it is, right? And so it's like pulling teeth. So to get their attention, we actually spent thousands of dollars going to education conferences. We never made money on any conference we went to, at least in terms of either selling there at the conference or connections that we had afterwards. But the people that we met there were invaluable. And you can meet some different distributors, get their attention, get their hands on the product, and that can yield some larger benefit later on. Get on the radar screen, and then maybe get in their catalog. But fundamentally, education is a very tough business. If you get in the right way, and you're smart about it, you watch your expenses, you partner with great people like Caspar and the Zappar team, you can produce a great product and you stand a chance. But again, you've got to be very smart about how you do it.
Yeah. Well, listen, we're almost out of time. So I guess one last question before we throw it open to the floor, really, which is where next? Given we've got, what can you tell us? What insider information can you impart about what you're up to next?
Well, so if you go to our website, we've got kind of a more broad kind of overview of what's next for us. But we're pretty excited about one that we've been talking to Caspar about for a little while now that relates to volcanoes. And this is something that was requested by a number of the teachers that I've had customers for a long time, volcanoes and plate tectonics. And so it's going to be volcanoes, and it's not going to be one of those plastic bags sealed. Here's a volcano, a cutaway, because who cares? But it's going to be dynamic. It's going to be interactive. There's going to be a story. There's going to be rescues and lots of ash and flames and volcanic lava. Some scientists may die in the process, but we'll try to keep that to a minimum.
No, indeed, that's going to be a lot of fun to get working on. Okay, right. So we're on to questions. Let me open this panel up and see what happens now. I've got to say this is going to show my lack of skills here. Audience Q&A. Let's see what we have.
No. I'm probably being digitally illiterate here in terms of what I can, if there's anything here. Right, well, so there's one about... have you thought about a deep sea adventure, Rockwell family? I think that topic would lend itself to AR really well.
You know, there's so many different topics. That's a brilliant one, Caspar. There are so many topics that would be fantastic for AR. Deep sea in particular would be fantastic from a kind of a head-mounted VR type setup. And I know that you've got some really amazing tools in that regard. And not to mention that the wand that you've got that is associated with ZapWorks that you know would allow people to interact with those scenes, which would be fantastic. But you know, for us, you know, we always begin with the curriculum. And given that we're here in Texas, we focus on the Texas curriculum. Here in the States, you know, you've got national standards, which most states use. Certain holdout states have their own standards. Texas is one of those. Texas is the second largest education market in the country after California, which itself uses the national standards. But so, you know, we want to provide as much bang for our buck. And so we begin with the standards. And so when we first looked at producing, you know, what was Solar System Expedition, we combed through them and said, okay, what topic can we cover that covers as many standards as possible relative to different grades? It was Solar System. We did that great reception. And then afterwards, we looked at that list again and said, okay, what's next? Water cycle, because it's covered across so many different grades. And that's it. Based on feedback and also the standards again, and volcanoes. So kind of working down the list. We've got a number of ideas and there's so many great opportunities that are out there.
Yeah. We had another person comment. So I teach design and illustration at a career at Tech High School. We had students create an AR picture book to teach younger students about our programs. The students illustrated, created the animations, shot the video, and printed the books in-house, using the books as a marketing campaign for the school. So less of a question, but I think that's a really interesting use case. And it you is. Know, I guess from a Zapper and a ZapWorks perspective, that's also something that we're, you know, really see an opportunity for, that actually using the tools for AR in order to teach kids a different set of skills, you know, about computing skills, actually Absolutely. About curation of content, about multimedia, about presentation, all of those things I think are really interested.
Well, to that point, Caspar, here in the States at least, things have evolved so much over the last 5 years. We've seen more broad-based adoption of technology, especially in the middle school market. We've seen so many different schools come out with, you know, dedicated programs that deal with 3D design. And so they're doing complex work in things like Tinkercad and SketchUp, which SketchUp is a free 3D modeling application that's included as part of the G Suite. So if they've got Google Classrooms, most people have Google Classrooms, then they've got access to it. Tinkercad is free, web-based. And so you've got all the tools there to create 3D content, and it's a perfect environment for the deployment of ZapWorks. So I think you guys are perfectly positioned for that.
Yeah, it's only been something that was, I mean, and it's really fun to do when you go into schools and you know you put the kids in groups, and you know it might be the topic might be about the about Egypt, you know, and getting them to curate content around that, build a poster, get that content, show it back to the class, take it home. You know, there's so many elements of that sort of helps support again that different way of engaging with a topic and learning sort of multifaceted things. We've got another question in. I might be misunderstanding, but it seems you're saying that the project you reviewed did not make a profit. What was your most popular AR project in education, and what projects caught on and why? Yeah, I think it's maybe a misunderstanding there. We're certainly not saying that it isn't profitable, but it certainly is hard to
very tough.
Think about the business model and think about your route to market, I think.
But to that point, Caspar, so you don't expect to make a profit, especially if you're building a business and a brand, for the first long while. Again, it's that valley of death. Eventually, for it to become a viable business and not a hobby, you've got to actually get out of that valley of death and actually start making money. But it does take a while. And that's true, by the way, that's true for not just this business and these products, but any product. You got to make an initial investment to develop it. And you've got to, you know, be smart about, you know, making sure that you make money at some point. So,
Yeah, absolutely. And I think I guess the question there about what's your most popular AR project in education and what projects cause on and why. I mean, I kind of go, you know, the essence of the framework of the lesson plans that you've created is proven and you know, evidential in terms of the hundreds of thousands, you know, scans that we've seen and sales of it and dwelt. Now it's about, you know, how do you more widely distribute it and how do we keep making sure that there's more content around it. One of the reasons I was interested in this webinar was that I would like to know tips for success. Do you have any advice for AR designers in education to be successful? Interesting.
Any thoughts, Caspar?
I think the thing that I always come back to on these things is and it sounds so trite in many, but it's just to try and keep it simple, actually. I think it's sometimes, you know, with AR, because there is so much you can do, it's very quick and easy to go fully blue sky and really, really go out there. And then you kind of need to come back and just go, well, why? And why would anyone do it? And how do I make it really quite simple? And so I would focus less on the technology itself and more on the storytelling and the content. And because you'd be amazed at how little things, you know, we had another project we did in education that was just about, much like someone said earlier, it's almost filming video with kids, putting that on a poster, making that come to life. Now that seems like, you know, that's been around for ages, but it's amazing how compelling that is in that school setting, done in the right way with the right narrative along with other pieces. So I think the tips would be, don't feel that you need to make something that is all singing, all dancing, you know, focus on what the story is and you know, make it the little things beautiful.
And if I could add to that, Caspar, I think you hit the nail on the head with it. Simplicity is important, but also relative to the AR content that you do develop, be efficient. And so if you look at either of these books, you know, Solar System Expedition in particular, you look at the sheer quantity of AR experiences that we have in there, and it's a large number. But really, from a development standpoint, relative to each of the different planet scenes, you kind of go to a planet, the planet pops up, launch a probe, you do repetitive stuff over and over again. So from a development standpoint, it was one development, and then we basically kind of swapped out, you know, this planet and then this planet and this planet. Facts. It made it much more efficient, much more, you know, bite-sized than it would have been otherwise.
Really good point. Yeah, making that framework, you know, spending more time up front in that sort of defining and designing before kind of going headlong into developing. Yeah, that's a really good point. Another one here, I can't access the Google Slide link to ask a question, but curious if anyone has done a similar STEM or educational focused ZapWorks experiences on a site like a museum or tourist site. We've certainly done work with museums and tours. You know, you get into some similar learnings, but some different learnings when you go into those spaces. I mean, the thing I always bang on about with any of this is the kind of a framework which I describe as the five C's, which again, little to do with the technology, but everything to do with about understanding the context of where you're asking people to use AR as a facilitating technology and how well you can control that environment, which becomes super important both in a classroom, in a museum, or on a tourist trail or site. And then it's about how you're telling them clearly what to do. What's the signposting in that call to action? And all of that has to be decided before you get to the content. And then after that's how are you telling people about all of those things to make sure that the experience is as good as it can be. So I think the idea of AR as an informational overlay, whether that's to a lesson plan, to any sort of exhibit in an exhibition or to a location, it's all the same in many ways, but you need to really, really kind of think about that moment of assistance and who your audience is and how you're guiding them to have that experience. something else here. I think a great thing about AR and Zappa's platform in particular is the ability for over-the-air updates to experience content. How useful is this at keeping educational content evergreen? Mm-hmm. That's a great point. you're right. It's incredibly useful. I don't know if you've, Matt, that was a thing that made your decision.
So we actually our content, the goals that we have with our lessons are static. At least we want to teach, hit topic A, B, C, and D relative to the solar system or the water cycle. So that's not dynamic. But when we first launched these books, we actually had on the instructions page a little kind of initial zap code that people could scan that would provide just a check to make sure that their application, the Zapper app was working. And the idea there was to actually put promotional information there relative to various things on that page. And given that we were updating these books, once a year across each of our different editions, we actually had a metric version and we had a US customer version. It was something that kind of went by the wayside, but it's something that it presents an opportunity from a promotional standpoint for us. But again, even relative to the expiration of this content, I mentioned it before, that's what allowed us to sell these initial PDFs and not just give away the farm, to where we could actually cut off those zap codes, dynamic updating, right? Saying, hey, sorry, it's expired. Please buy the content. It's fantastic. It really is fantastic for that, dynamically managing that.
I think, the thing that you always have to watch with any of these bits of content, I think is another critical importance, is just how big those payloads are. How do you make and design things that aren't going to be, tens of megabytes in size, because you we're only going to be as good as the Wi-Fi or network connectivity, whether it is wherever it is. So there are lots of things that you kind of have to bear in mind when designing for these. But that over the air bit certainly helps. And I guess now we're also at a point where there is a choice between, do you do this natively in an app, or now do you do it through mobile web AR, which again kind of opens up other sort of ease of distribution channels, which is good. I think that is pretty much us drawing to a close. We've only got a couple of minutes left, really. So Matt, I kind of want to say thank you, a massive thank you for joining us and sharing your journey so far. It's great that we've got more stuff kind of waiting in the wings to hopefully release in the not too near future, or not too distant future, I mean. Thanks for taking the time, and thanks everyone for joining us as well. I really do think that the opportunity for AR in education is something that we're only really scratching the surface of. And it's so exciting to see people like Matt and Stone Oak actually really go deep and go long and try and get across that valley of death, as you talked about, to pull through the other side. And I'm sure it'll gather momentum. Finally, if you do want to find out more about Stone Oak and our work in education, we have posted links to Zapworks and the Stone Oak website in the chat. And we will also be sending out all the resources from this webinar along with the recording tomorrow. So thanks again, and we will see you all soon.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.